9-16. How can a young person stay on the path of purity by living in accordance to your word? I speak with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commandments. I have hidden your words in my heart, that I might not sin against you. Praise be to you, Lord. Teach me your decrees. With my lips I recount all the laws that cometh from your mouth. I rejoice in the following your statutes, as one rejoices in the great riches. I meditate on your precepts and consider your ways. I delight in your decrees. I will not neglect your word.
Morning makes a church. Let the church say amen. All right, I don't know about you, but I'm extremely encouraged already this morning. I just love it when our Spanish-speaking brothers and sisters can come together and worship with us. Amen. We truly look like the first century church. We have Edison somewhere among us speaking in tongues, translating the language so that all can be edified this morning. Before you, just to give a brief introduction of our speaker, Brother Delton McGuire. He is married to Valerie. Him and his wife have worked with children and families in Christian childcare and education for over 26 years. His experiences include preaching ministry, therapeutic foster care, and college teaching. In graduate school, he specialized in media effects, which laid the foundation for the presentations that we are going to receive today. Along with the World Church Ministry work, he is also a past Church of Christ deacon and elder. Delta is presently the Chief Development Officer for a Church of Christ affiliated children's home, where he also served as a house parent and an executive director. He is a graduate of Oklahoma Christian University and Stephen F. Austin State University. He is married with 3 grown children, and he has 4 grandchildren. His extensive training and past experiences have prepared him to well speak on the topics of media and its effect with the families. I want to thank you so much for all those who are visiting with us this morning. Thank you for partaking in this worship and sit along with us. Please be reminded that there will be a fellowship meal following our worship service. And we just pray that Delton will identify us in the privileges as he's already done during our meal with us. Thank you.
First, let me begin saying thank you. I very, very much appreciate the opportunity to be here. The topic of this time slot isn't directly related to the media. As I mentioned this morning in my presentation, the real issue we're dealing with here is basic morality and how we as parents teach morality to our children and how we teach about our faith to our children. The media just happens to be one of those problem areas that we have to deal with in the meantime. For this particular session, I wanted to speak on something positive rather than things that are troublesome. So I was asked once after I did my presentation, the church called me up about a month later. They said, "Delton, we would like you to talk about being a family." And of course, first words out of my mouth were, "I'm not a social worker," and they said, "We'll do it anyway." So I put together this lesson, and it has been received so well many times. I decided to again present it this morning. Even though it's not directly related to the media, it's very much indirectly related to it. It's entitled Building Stronger Christian Families. A number of years ago, a study was conducted by a professor of family practices at Oklahoma State University, OSU. Instead of looking at what was wrong with families, what was wrong with dysfunctional families, he looked at what was working well for well-functioning families. He came upon 6 key ideas, and I want to share those with you this morning, but of course, adding to that the biblical perspective related to these key notes. The key characteristics of a well-functioning Christian family are: number 1, appreciation is expressed. Number 2, good communication skills are present. They spend time together. They're committed to the family. They have a high degree of religious orientation, and they have the ability to deal with a crisis when it occurs, not if it occurs. I spent some time looking at each one of these this morning, and seeing how God wants us to be with our families. first one was expressing appreciation. This number one on purpose. One of the most, if not the most significant characteristic of strong families is they consistently express their appreciation to each other. They build each other up psychologically. They make each family member feel good about themselves and about their role in the family. We all want to be appreciated. All of us do, all the time. But we want it more from those that we're close to more than we want it from others. On the other hand, related to that, experts say that when we're communicating, that 80% of our communication and 80% of our expressions need to be positive. Now, this actually follows the example of Paul in the letters that he writes. Typically, in most of the epistles, there's a series of compliments and encouragements beginning. Then he deals with whatever the problem was at hand. He's writing a letter. But he ends with strong encouragement. Some people call this the sandwich method. It works well with our families if we'll just do it. We have biblical teaching to back this up. Paul wrote in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 29, "Let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers." If we did this and did it consistently, our worlds would change. A similar idea is found in 1 Thessalonians 5:11, where again Paul wrote, "Therefore comfort each other and edify one another, just as you also are doing." Well, how can we do this? Well, to start off with, you can sit together, whether that's at church or especially at home. Sit together as a family and tell each other what you appreciate about each other. Try to give each other at least one compliment a day. You can do it. Watch the speech patterns to make sure the speech patterns are mostly positive and decrease the number of negative comments that are coming from you. This will allow us, as the mother and father, to set the speech patterns within our home. Our children will imitate what we do, good and bad. So if they're hearing good things from you, they will imitate those good comments as well. Your world will be positively better if most of what is said within your family is said in a positive way. I'm going to read Ephesians 4:29 again. "Let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers." Secondly, well-functioning families have developed good communication patterns. You might not have thought about it much, but your family is a system. It works as a system. It has definable traits, habits, and patterns. And because of this, one glitch in the family can and will mess things up, and they'll stop those positive processes that you may have begun. We need to not mess with the system. And most of our systems within our families are dependent upon communication. Now, the experts tell us that only 7% of our communication is verbal. And what we mean by that is the words that I'm using, this is my field, so I'm familiar with this. The words that we're using are only a piece of the communication process. That leaves 93% of what we say is nonverbal. Now, what does it mean? It means if I got loud, I changed the tone. If I got too quiet, I changed the tone. That's almost half of our communication. And the other half of it is going to be, how am I standing and looking at you? Or how am I sitting and looking at you? Have you ever said something super nice to a person that got mad at you? Right? It's because of the way you look or your voice tone when they said it. So let's remember that. Let's just remember, it's a simple thing. But let's remember, most of communication has very little to do with words. And on the topic that I'm speaking of today, why do we communicate so poorly on our electronic devices? It's because 93% of the methods of communication isn't there. It's words only. Words only are a very, very poor way to communicate. They claim that 38% voice tone and 55% nonverbal is how we communicate. Now, y'all, I've been married 38 years. I learned a long time ago how important this topic is, because I will often say things that I thought I said one thing, and my wife said I said something different. Right? Completely different. It all had to do, in my case, with my voice tone more than anything else. Remember, it makes all the difference in the world. But when you mix these three ideas together, it is amazing that we don't have even more problems trying to communicate with one another. If the message that we're trying to send gets received by the receiver the way we meant it to be, it is almost a miracle. And so we got to work hard at this, to do it as well as we can. And sometimes we do better as families if we'll learn these communication patterns. I have to tell you for just a moment that my wife and I, like I said, we've been married 38 years. We finally had, about a year ago, came to the conclusion that whoever said it gets interpreted. All right? Whoever said it gets interpreted. Not the person who heard it, the person who said it. Okay? That settles hundreds of arguments about what one has said and didn't say. So the speaker gets interpreted in our family. We come to agreement on that. It works well. Can we make these patterns and verbal templates work for us? Paul told us in Ephesians chapter 4:15, verse 15, but speaking the truth in love may grow up in all things to him who is head, Christ. Speaking the truth in love can help us more than any other communication pattern that we have. This means that we say things with a good intent to the other person because we love them. 1 Corinthians 13:16 tells us that love does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in truth. Another powerful communication pattern that involves restoring mutual respect and admiration for each other and consideration. Surely, the part of honoring your mother and father, the first commandment with a promise, is to show basic respect and consideration for them. The scripture reads in Ephesians 6:1-2, children, obey your parents in the Lord. In Ephesians chapter 4, verses 31 and 32, we learn that this applies to our physical families as much as it does to our spiritual families. But we think it does apply as much. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you. If all of our families decided to start living out this message of being nice to each other, it would revolutionize our families. Now, let's spend just a little bit more time on communication. One thing is clear from a lot of studies. Strong families encourage the free expression of feelings, both positive and negative. Now, in our society, sometimes we as men don't feel free to express our feelings as much as women do. That's part of how we've been raised. The odds are right. By allowing men to express their feelings, you give them the opportunity to show their children and their wife what they really believe and why they believe it. Remember, their emotions are never right or wrong in and of themselves. They're natural. Remember I said we're a family system? We need to know how the other parts of the family are working so that we can rejoice together and work together with them. But you also need to remember, especially later in our children, that individual differences should be recognized. And as long as those differences are not in conflict with God's Word, and sometimes they can be, but as long as those differences are not in conflict with God's Word, then you need to be okay with it. And when it comes to our children again, it is okay for them to be different from each other. Again, as long as it doesn't conflict with morally positive characteristics, we should let our children grow to be as they are. Another key way to communicate as a family is to spend time doing it. The digital doesn't count. That can be a sermon all by itself. I remember one of my most offending moments was sitting across the dinner table from my daughter and one of those people sitting there. And I tell myself a story for about the 50th time. And they're texting rude comments back and forth to each other about my story. Okay? Across the kitchen table. Digital can be rude, y'all. All right? But we also need to listen actively. The six simple steps to listen actively: concentrate on what's being said, listen carefully. Listen to the message before you start looking for a solution. That's a male problem. We try to find a solution before you even put the whole problem. Sit through the relevant data. Check with the speaker to make sure that you heard them right. And make sure the speaker knows that you heard them and that you're concerned. We need to develop positive communication patterns. It's a biblical concept as well as just a human relations concept. Focus on the intent of the message and acknowledge each other. Remember, all this starts with the parents making the first effort to teach the children to do this work. The third characteristic was well-functioning families spending time together. It's a hard thing to do. Everything gets in the way. How much time you spend together depends on two things. Number one, your degree of cohesion. Just how much in togetherness are you? Families are different. Too little togetherness can be bad. Too much togetherness can be bad. But also your degree of adaptability. Again, extremes are not good. Our children do have to develop their own autonomy, even related to the media issues that we're speaking of today. But they need guidance on how to get there. It's up to you as parents to show them how they should grow up. And you can't do that if you're not around them enough. I have to say that my kids are grown. And as they grew up, we started going to family, two things, graduations, weddings, things like that. Where my children have the opportunity to say things about Daddy. Did you know they can pretty well quote everything I ever said? It could be 15 years ago, and they can quote me word for word. One thing I'll say in my other presentations, is that we think our children aren't listening. They are. Because they'd rather listen to you than anybody. Right? They'd rather listen to their parents. They really would. But they're not. That's not what they care. It's not their job ever to care what you think. What's the time you spend with your family? Help your children to grow up responsibly. Let's look at how the work side of this thing. The work is the real problem. We've got our kids that have all their various school activities, their whatever the age is, they have all kinds of things. Something's always going on. But in most of our homes, are the mother and father both work. To spend time together, you need to plan things together. You need to set your priorities. You need to monitor organized activities. There may be a time when you say enough is enough. We had to do this with our 11th grade daughter one time. We said, Katie, you got way too many things going. You can't be normal. You can't even be happy trying to do all those things. Slow down. We had to make her do it. But she was happier than we've done. But you need to control your work schedule also. And most of us work. You'll need to also agree as a family about what you're going to do and how you're going to do it. Sometimes you may need a compromise between what you'd like to do and what your children like to do. But find that compromise. Let me tell you that sometimes you got to go to, since we're almost to extremes if you want to spend time with your family. When I was in graduate school, my children were 5, 7, and 9. And I had a full-time job, and I was a full-time student. And as I said, I had a full-time family. What do I do? My kids are more familiar with the SFA library than any student on the visit. So I was doing a thesis that was all historical based. They lived in the library with me. Now, that wasn't full-fledged sit down and talk to them quality time, but at least the drive back and forth, which is 45 minutes, gave me time with my family and with my kids. Years later, I went to work for Children's Home. I had to travel every Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday. And there wasn't a Sunday night or Wednesday night that I didn't take one of my kids. Car time, automobile time, is great time with your kids. Remember that. You don't have to do everything together, but do some things together. Balance is the key. Number four, we need to cultivate commitment. Commit to the family. The term commitment hasn't always fallen into good opinion of commitment. The successful families are committed to each other. What are the ingredients of family commitment? Very quickly, they are respect, trust, acceptance, mutual goals, affirmation of each other, unselfishness, responsibility to each other, understanding each other's needs, honesty in everything, participation in the family system, abiding by positive family traditions, and religion. We'll come back to that. We should cultivate commitment through our faith as well. as a family, we need to make commitments to the husband and wife relationship as well. Let's face it, y'all, we all know that if that one falls apart, it's going to fall apart. And as husband and wife, we need to be committed to our relationship one with another and always try to work hard to strengthen it and make it better. Because if that part falls apart, the family falls apart. The fifth characteristic was healthy Christian families affirm their religious values. What are the characteristics of a Christian family? A Christian focus on a family? As a family, as an individual, that will give you a sense of purpose and meaning. After all, Christianity is goal-oriented. It gives us a purpose. It gives us meaning for our lives. The psalmist, Job, and the writer of Ecclesiastes all dealt with the universality of this topic. After all, as Christians, our ultimate purpose is to glorify God. We can glorify God through our children if we work hard at it. Few things will last forever. But what we leave with our children will last for a very, very long time. Neil Postman is considered one of the greatest scholars in the field of mass communication. I chose the field of study. And he wrote what is my favorite non-biblical quote. He wrote, "Children are living messages we send to a time we will not see. Children are living messages we send to all of us as parents, at the level of responsibility we have to teach our children. Our legacy with our children, whether it's good or bad, will have eternal influences. Our faith gives our lives purpose and meaning. But another effect of being a family of faith is gaining the strength and support that comes from the larger community of faith, the church. Being a family of faith gives us more patience when times get difficult. Being a family of faith helps us know how to forgive better. Why? Because Christ forgave us. Being a family of faith helps us foster positive attitudes that align with each other. And finally, being a family of faith gives us the common values of faith within our family and out to share within our family system. So what are the marks of a strong religious family? Sensitive to spiritual needs of each other. They practice their faith in some form all the time. They see the church as a larger support system, a greater family. A strong religious family assumes this responsibility for spiritual training of the children in the home, in addition to what they may receive at the church building as well. And finally, the last trait of strong Christian families is they deal positively with the crisis. A crisis is an emotional response to a hazardous situation. Crisis occurs when people find themselves unable to solve a problem by normal means. Why do some people cope well and some don't? Well, those that cope well typically have plans for it. It doesn't mean they sit around worrying all the time. It means that they know that something may occur and they're prepared for it. They're able to keep their cool. They're able to keep their heads clear because when the crisis hits, because they've made some preparation. Now, admittedly, some families lack support systems. And that's when we, as their neighbor, we, as their brother or sister, whatever the case may be, we need to be ready with a support system to help them, both within the church and without. Families that succeed dealing with the crisis put their faith into play when the crisis occurs. They're religiously grounded. Paul wrote in Romans chapter 8, verse 28, "And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to His promise." Knowing this allows us to focus. James told us how to cope in James 1, verses 2 through 4. He wrote, "My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing." Families that make it through a crisis, they've had past expenses, they're open to their feelings, they're willing to be flexible in their approach to the new crisis. A crisis produces growth. We need to prepare for it. It will occur. In conclusion, let's look at how this mix of ingredients help us be a well-functioning family? Or how we can do it? Number one, decide that you want to be a stronger family. Number two, begin by doing the things that strong families do. Third, study on the topic. Read your Bible. Read other books that help you keep your family system working properly. And reach out to other families that need help. And be available to them when they need that help. And finally, the most important thing you can do, you can pray. Because families are in trouble. So let's pray about our children, and about our families, and everybody and every opportunity we have. This has not been a gospel sermon, but it's been one that I do hope will encourage you and help you be the kind of family you need to be. But at the same time, we never want to leave here not giving the opportunity to those that have needs that need to be made known. There may be those that need to come to baptism there, there may be those that need prayers. What it is, we want to take care of that now as we stand this morning.